Welcome to Fisher's Point. You will see some slightly familiar faces on the stage today. We are kind of, are we the B team? We're the A.
Probably.
We're the A plus team.
Okay, we'll go.
All right, I have a few announcements for us as we get started this morning. First of all, you should see a connection card somewhere near you. If you can take a moment to fill that out and give us your information. We will not ask you for money. We will contact you to say thanks for being here and how we can pray for you. You can just drop that in the offering plate later. So we have a few announcements. We are collecting alabaster offering on Sunday. On Sunday, September 15th. If you don't know, alabaster money is used to build churches, hospitals, schools in places where it's needed, both around the world and in the United States. So if you could please grab a box from the foyer and fill it with all your loose change. In my home church in Texas, we always had a contest to see who could bring the most unique thing. And we had people bring cowboy boots full of change and a box. Like, it was kind of a competition, so I encourage that too. Also, don't forget, on the bulletin board in the foyer is a sign-up. We need hosts for our youth group. We don't have a permanent home on Sunday nights for the teens to meet, but we also would like for them to get to know you better. So if you would be willing to host our youth group, you'll see the sign-up sheet in the foyer. Also, it's every Sunday, or most Sundays, 6 to 7:30, and you're also expected to provide a light meal, like lobster and steak, right? Yeah. Not really. Yeah, everyone's welcome. So. All right, also, if you would like to help create the PowerPoint, we need a few people to be on this team. Because he's not here, I'm just going to tell you, I'm not sure if everyone's aware, Pastor Landon is usually the person who does it most of the time. And as you know, he's extremely busy. So this would take a lot off of his shoulders if someone could volunteer to do it once a month. So if you're able to do that, please talk to Pastor Landon. Like, send him an email this week. He's thankfully on vacation this weekend. And finally, we are still the oatmeal church. We collect boxes of instant oatmeal to donate to Shepherd Community Center. So while you're out shopping, pick up a box or two. It doesn't matter the brand or the flavor. Just get it and bring what you have. And then, I don't know, Teresa, do you usually deliver that? Teresa will deliver it eventually. We get a stockpile and then we create it. All right, I think that's it. Are we ready?
Let's do this. This is a clear warning. I have been coming off of a creeping crud, so if I'm singing an octave lower than normal, or if I just stop and start coughing, bear with me. But we're going to make a joyful noise together, shall we? Let's stand.
Bring your dreams.
is probably one of my favorite memories I have growing up. This song was like, if a church could have a theme song, this was, I grew up at the Nazarene Church in Noblesville, and this was their theme song. Like, I think there was one time, like six Sundays in a row, we sang this, and the pastor was like, okay, we're gonna need to have an intervention. We need a different song. So, and I'll tell you, not only was it one of our favorite songs, but it's one of the coolest messages I think we can keep in mind, because I don't know if you're like me, but like, the Bible just seems so old sometimes. And like, these stories, yeah, I know they're supposed to have like modern day ramifications on our lives, but sometimes it just feels so separate. It doesn't feel like these are the days of Moses, because like, I'm not in the desert, and I'm not looking for food and water, but these are the days of Moses. Righteousness is being restored right here in 2024. These are the days of David, and we are rebuilding the temple as a church. And so this song gives me a great perspective of like, these are still the days. These are not days in the past. These are days that I live every single day. And I, even though I don't have a beard and a staff and I'm parting the Red Sea, I am a modern day Moses. I am the one that God has called to restore righteousness and be a light on the hill. I'm the worker in the field that's supposed to be gathering in. So it's a good song, it's got a great beat, it's got a great verse and chorus and a good hook to it, but it's also got a great, great message to it. So join me, Days of Elijah.
Restore, and though these are days.
share some scripture with us this morning.
Nothing I have done nor deserved that salvation comes. Father, our next song talks about how deep your love is for us. I can't imagine a deeper love. I don't understand why sometimes that I gain from your sacrifice, that I should be the one that reaps the reward. But Father, I am so humbled and amazed that as you were dying on a cross, through no fault of your own, you were bearing my sins. You knew my name on that cross. You knew all of our names. What a humbling thought to know that the Son of God was able to know my name.
Yeah.
Know my name and bear a burden that I could never, ever carry. Father, these tithes and these offerings are so little compared to that. But Father, just as you did with your Son on the mount with the loaves and the fishes, I know that this small amount can be broken and multiplied to not only impact this church, this community, but to impact the world. So Father, take what we give, let us be good stewards, and let us multiply this for the good of your kingdom. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
How deep
His wounds have been my
We have the privilege of having Dr. Andy, not Stanley, but Hughes with us today. So Dr. Hughes, please come share the word with us.
All right, great, thank you. Let me turn this on here. So they marked my territory for me so that the video will work. Some of you may remember that I shared with you last time that much like my son-in-law, that's my wife, my grandchildren, my daughter, and my son-in-law right over there. And this is the first time that my grandchildren get to hear me preach. Is that not good? So you need to say a lot of amens and make me look good, right? Can you do that? So much like my son-in-law, I also grew up, if you remember, in a foreign land that in its native tongue is called Kentucky. And so English is my second language. I speak Kentucky fluently. We have a text that we're going to get to in just a moment, and it's pretty weighty. And so I'm going to tell you a story first before we dig into this very weighty and often misunderstood passage. So I'm going to be fairly animated. So the sound folks are going to go a little nuts, probably trying to keep my tone in check. But I will do my very best to not blow out anyone's eardrums or anything of that nature. But so this is the story. I mentioned early on that I'm from Kentucky. So I want to tell you a story about this Nazarene preacher from Kentucky. Now, I want you to really pay attention about this Nazarene preacher in Kentucky. He just arrived in Kentucky. He wanted to assimilate with his congregation. And he was in horse country there in Kentucky. And so he thought to himself, he said, I'm a Nazarene pastor. I'm a Nazarene preacher. And I need to find a way to make sure that I am connecting with my people. And they all love horses. They all love horses. So I'm going to get me a horse, but in order to make sure that it's the right horse, it needs to be a holy horse.
Amen.
Preach. A holy horse. And so he was really kind of perplexed on what holiness looked like. Oftentimes people are perplexed about what holiness looks like. And so he went around to a lot of the farmers in the area, and he would knock on the door, and he would say, I'm here, I'm the pastor at so-and-so Nazarene Church, and I'm here to buy a holy horse, a righteous horse. Because you really have to kind of get that going if you're going to make that work. And so most of the time, the farmers would say, what are you talking about? We don't have you, city slicker. What are you doing? So they would slam the door. And he knocked. He was a very persistent, because holiness is about persevering. Holiness is about persistency. And so he wanted to demonstrate that. So he kept on knocking. He kept on asking. He kept on getting doors slammed in his face until one day he knocked on the door. And he said, and almost, he was this close to defeat. He said, sir, do you happen to have a holy horse? And the farmer said, yes, I do have a holy horse. It's going to cost you a little more than a typical horse, but it's a holy horse. And he said, what makes it holy? And he said, I've trained this horse. I trained it. I've spiritually trained it, disciplined it to go on hallelujah and woe on amen. Right. And he goes, I don't know what you're talking about, because he's a Nazarene pastor, he's a little slow. And he said, not all, just some. And but they go on because he asks us. I'm just kidding. Dr. Wangler, he's a good friend. So he gets on there. First thing he gets on there, he goes, go! Go! Horsey, go! He didn't go. And a pharmacist did not do this. He said, he didn't ask me any preacher that I don't understand. Remember, hallelujah, you. And amen, you. Whoa, right? So he also then he goes, I'm going to try it right now. He goes, hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. And boy, he's getting it. But back behind him in the field, there was some farmers, other farmers hunting. And the gun goes off, that horse, he gets scared, he goes, and he gets nervous. He's just scared to death. And he goes, and he forgot the word. And he said, stop, stop, whoa, stop, stop, whoa, stop. And then he remembered, he was this close to the edge, this close to the edge of the cliff. And he said, amen. Whew, hallelujah. And there he goes. So I hope that you recognize that discipline is essential. In fact, we know my role as the dean of the school of the DeVoe School of Business, Technology, and Leadership, we're all about artificial intelligence. Have you heard about artificial intelligence? Yeah. There's a lot of artificial intelligence out in the world. You listen to any politician and you realize that's the case. But one of the things that artificial intelligence and human intelligence have in common is the power of the question. In prompt engineering, you have to phrase the question because you're training the person on the other side. And what they discovered in educational circles is that people who are curious, that one trait is the number one predictor of academic success. Not grades in high school, not SATs or ACTs, but people who are innately curious. So with that, I'm going to ask you to stand. As we look at our text, this is a curious text. This is a text that can be off-putting without understanding its context, its meaning. These are the words of Jesus, so they're important. So as I read this, I want you to keep in mind that this is not really a sermon to new believers. This sermon is more about those who are on the path, who are traveling on the way. This is our text, St. Luke chapter 14, verses 25 through 35. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father, mother, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and wasn't able to finish. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 10,000 or 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and ask for terms of peace. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor the manure pile. It is thrown out. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for its challenge. We ask, Lord, that you would help its truth to penetrate our soul. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen.
So, when I was 22, and my wife and I were taking our first church in Texas, Mineola, Texas, I was on the Dallas district.
That's where I grew up.
That's where you grew up. So you know this man I'm going to speak of. There's a legend in the Church of the Nazarene that I fell in love with, and he, without even knowing it, helped to mentor me, Ponder Gillian, the legendary Ponder Gillian, who was a long-term pastor, district superintendent. He was also president of Bethany Nazarene College, became Southern Nazarene University. He was one of the youngest, in fact, the youngest, up until another really close friend of mine, Dr. M.V. Scott, we call him Bud, beating by a year, to be the youngest district superintendent in the history of our denomination. Ponder Gillian was known as an orator. And when I was 22, he was 75. And he was pastoring the Dallas First Church of the Nazarene. He was brilliant. And so he used some of the bones of this sermon, the 3 points I'm going to share with you, as a way to describe the question that he asked 30 plus years ago. This is the question. And I want you to listen to it. I want you to hear it. I want it to soak into the very being of who you are, and I want you to marinate in it. The question is this. Is Jesus everything to me, or is he something less? I'm going to say this again. I'm going to say it a little slower. Is Jesus everything to me, or is he something less? I have to be honest with you. That question has haunted me most of my career. But as I mentioned with artificial intelligence, a question can train you. Maybe a question can even disciple you. Maybe that question can create inside of you certain disciplines. Essentially, that question is the question that Jesus unpacks in this text. I gotta be honest with you. When I read this text and I see hate, my mother, my father, my family, I love my family. How can Jesus ask me to do that? Well, you see, here's the problem with English. Sometimes English doesn't really capture the meaning. So if you look at the Greek, you would understand that the translation of the words, kai, al, messiah, which is the English, and does not hate, refers to deciding towards a particular loyalty rather than prioritizing affection. Let me say it again. The Greek meaning, the meaning in the tradition that it was written in the New Testament. New Testament is basically Koine Greek, and you've got Hebrew, Aramaic that's mixed in the Old Testament. So in the Greek, the proper translation of this phrase in English to hate is really not about prioritizing affection, but about a particular loyalty. Because in this day and time, you've got to understand, disciples of Jesus, it was a scandal. It was scandalous. During the life of Jesus, post the life of Jesus, Christianity was a scandal. And you were often pitted between folks who would discredit the gospel, who often were in your same family. And and following Jesus. So Jesus is letting them know. What has your loyalty priority? What do you prioritize as your top loyalty? When it comes down to it, you have to make a choice. You have to make a decision. You have to decide. Which line are you going to decide on? Even if your family, another way of saying this text, even if your family was to disavow you for your belief or erode the gospel or come against the gospel, who would you choose? Do you understand? It's not about affection. Jesus is not out of sync with James Dobson and focus on the family. Love your family. Embrace your family. Adore your family. But is Jesus everything to you, or is he something less? Is Jesus everything to me, or is he just a little less? How do we get there? How do we understand? One cannot magically leap from acceptance of Christ to committed relationship, no more than one who meets a blind date can be prepared instantly for the intimacy of marriage. That doesn't mean that you knew that she or he was the one. But it takes time to develop that deepness, that intimacy. My wife and I used to do these marriage retreats. We did it for several years. And we had someone ask a question once, and the question was, how long does it take? We just celebrated 10 years, and I hadn't married this couple, because that was at my last assignment for a long time. How long does it take for you to really figure out this thing called marriage? We've been together 10 years. I think we should have it figured out by now. I said, honey, she's like another daughter to me. I said, honey, it takes 10 years to know the questions, let alone figure out the answers. Right? You don't just arrive at intimacy with a glance. It takes work. Marriage is a great institution, or it'll put you in one. Right? It takes work. It takes effort. It takes time. It takes understanding. So it is, there is no button to push or incantation to say which suddenly propels you towards Christian maturity. No, it takes an extreme amount of effort. It takes discipline. It's amazing to me how much we despise discipline. My wife used to watch kids when our children were little. And so she was interviewing a client that came over to the house, knocked on the door, and brought in her child. And she, first question was, do you discipline the children? So my wife said, in love, but I want to protect them, and these are the rules that we have in the house that everybody has to obey. And she said, not my child. My child needs no discipline. My three-year-old just needs to experience life. Really? We don't like the word discipline. Christ explained to his disciples, if you truly decide to follow him, there will be a cost. I think sometimes, I'm going to set this back, right, so I can see you and not look over you. I've got the rest memorized. So. And you don't know what I wrote, so you wouldn't know if I did or I didn't. So. Here's the thing. I think sometimes in my own ministry, in my own development of other pastors over the years, I may have placed too much emphasis on the thinking about faith, the emotions of faith. I'm not a hairy tick. I do know that it is by grace that we come to faith.
Amen.
Right? But I also believe that if we see faith as a relational approach, like any good relationship, it takes effort and commitment. Sometimes I think in our current culture, in our current generation, we are so afraid, the church is so afraid of offending folks, that we accommodate folks and we try to minimize the cost of discipleship. I'm gonna do this one for you. Preach it, brother! Woo! Glory! Right? That's truth, right? That's truth. Jesus said that. I didn't. Don't get mad at me. Jesus said it. Jesus said, hey, look, if you're going to be a disciple, you got to consider the cost. Which means there's an investment. So I have a lot of programs. I've been in business for a long time, around business. And I use the business mantra that my father, who was almost illiterate, taught me. Probably the wisest information I've ever been given about business. And it's pretty much two things. One, if people want to give you money, find a way to take it. That's pretty basic, right? How many of you have ever done anything and it was tough to give them money? And you're like, I'm sort of buying. Can you just, you know, you're on hold 400 times and just let me buy it, right? Number two, business is distilled down, not his term, my term, to two categories, right? It's really easy. Figure out the difference between your investments and your expenses. Minimize your expenses and fortify your investments. If you believe that your faith is everything to you, you're going to invest. Energy, time, effort, commitment. Maybe it shouldn't be so easy. Have you thought about that? Maybe it shouldn't be such an easy thing to do. So I'm going to ask you the question again that haunts me. Is Jesus everything to me, or is he something less? This is not for folks who are new to the faith. This is really a statement of folks who are on the journey, who's moving toward discipleship, who's counting the cost, who's considering the risk, who understands that the question, is Jesus everything to me, or is he something less, is the core question in our faith.
Amen.
How do we do that? Connor Gillian had 3 points. I have no poem today, but I'll give you 3 points. And they're from a man much smarter than me. Ponder gave these points. Number one, a discipline that you need to put into place if you want to make Jesus everything to you. It's the discipline of the rejection of lesser priorities.
Amen.
It's often when you are on this spiritual walk of maturity, it's often not about what is bad and good. It's usually about what's better and best. You have to create that. We see that with Jesus, right? He chose not to get married, but he embraced marriage. In fact, his first miracle occurred at a marriage. So that's his endorsement. He believes in marriage, but he knew for his mission, his purpose, he couldn't. St. Paul knew for his mission, he couldn't. So let me ask you, for your mission, What priorities are you going to reject that are lesser? That keep you, that keep me from making Jesus everything and not something less? Rejection of lesser priorities. Number two, this discipline of releasing things to the providence of God. Releasing things to the providence of God. There are certain things that you cannot control. There are certain things that you cannot conquer. But if you continue to force your way on these things, it's going to distract you from the disciplines of making Jesus everything.
Amen.
So those things, you gotta let go. You think about Jesus in the middle of the storm in the boat. He had been working so hard and he was tired and he was asleep, and a storm comes up and the disciples, they get nervous. And so they go and they wake him up. Gets up, calms the storm. But in that particular moment, Jesus knew something innately that we need to know. He trusted God with the things that was necessary to trust God with.
Right.
Folks, I think in this world, do you realize we are the most anxious generation that's ever lived? In fact, millennials and centennials, a study that was done stated that 70% are under the weight of extreme anxiety. 70%. In fact, not even that age bracket is the only one that suffers anxiety. We all do. And it usually stems around things that we can't control. And it distracts us. It demotivates us. But when you release things to the providence of God, those things that you cannot conquer, those things that you cannot control, I don't know if there's going to be war tomorrow, but I'm going to trust God.
Amen.
I don't know what my job's going to bring forth. All I can do is the very best I can every day and trust God.
Amen.
I place it into the providence of God. If you don't, you'll become so distracted with the things you can't control, you will not do the things you need to do. Third, and as I was a pastor for couple decades, and now I consult with pastors and the denomination. One of the things that I was horrible about is this one. Refuse to pretend. Let me give you an example. Somebody would call me at 2 in the morning. They go, "Pastor, are you awake?" What's my response?
"I'm here."
What's the old joke that Mark Lowry said? He named us that the Word, so anytime anybody bothered me, said, "I'm in the Word." Right? If you had a hard week, are you tired?
"No, I'm doing well."
Refuse to pretend. The Pharisees, Jesus would point out constantly, when they were fasting, they would put ashes on their face so that they would look as though they had been starving to death for centuries. Refuse to pretend. You know what? Community is essential. And when you pretend that the world hasn't weighed on you more than it should have, and you don't leverage the resources that God has given you in others, you will be defeated in your disciplines. Refuse to pretend. There's a great story that was written by Nathaniel Hawthorne. It's one of my favorite stories. It's called The Great Stone Face. Essentially, have you guys heard of The Great Stone Face?
Right.
Essentially, it tells the story of this village. And in this village, there was a carving in a mountain. And the lore went this way, that the next leader, the leader that would rescue us and save us, will look like the person in that mountain. That was the lore in The Great Stone Face. So a lot of false people that kind of looked like The Great Stone Face. They would come, they were charlatans, they were pretenders, they were politicians. And they would try to promote themselves in a way that made people think that they were The Great Stone Face. But then their actions would prove that they weren't the leader that was sent. It would go on and go on. But there was this little boy, maybe my grandson's age, that was in awe of The Great Stone Face. So every day he would climb up to the adjacent mountain and he would sketch The Great Stone Face. From the time that he was 6, 10, and 13, all the while these false leaders would come. He would sketch, and he would sketch, until he was an adult. And then someone looked at him and said, "You're the Great Stone Face." He had spent so much time studying The Great Stone Face that he became The Great Stone Face. That's discipleship. Is Jesus everything to me, or is he something less? In the midst of this Labor Day, I hope you all get a chance to rest and relax. And that's important. A respite from work. Quite possibly. Would you consider that question? Maybe that question can train you. Maybe the more we study that question, the more we study the Redeemer, we'll start to look more like him than we ever thought we could. Father, we are so very thankful for these folks and this very difficult text. And we thank you, Father, for your graciousness to speak truth to us. And we ask, Lord, that you would help us to learn the disciplines that are so essential as we become more like you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Of the goodness
Just remember,
so I didn't know either.
Let me get right straight to it. I had no idea.
I know exactly what she's talking about. I just didn't know if I'd be able to read it.
Get there fast enough.
It just ended.
So what?